Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. A blessed Sunday to all of y'all out there. This is Pastor Donald Wayne Dickman here once again. I pray that you all are keeping well in the Lord. Today I have a very interesting message I'll share to you, and I pray that you'll be blessed. I was praying for a message that God has for all of y'all out there, and God led me to this message. A text that's so dear to me. I've shared the message in different ways at different times because it's a great encouragement. As we look at Ezekiel 37 in the Old Testament, we see here the Bible talks about Ezekiel having a vision. Let me read a few verses. Verse 1, the hand of the Lord was upon me, carried me out in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down amidst a valley which was full of bones. And he caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. Again he said to me, prophesy upon these bones and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. If you read this text, the entire text, carry on looking at the verses as I address the points here. The important gist of the story here, or the gist of the happenings here, is Ezekiel was taken in a vision and by the Holy Spirit. And in the vision he was taken to a valley that is full of dry bones. Dry, parched bones. It's a very gloomy sight. And this is the vision that he had just after he prophesied that God is going to bring them back to the nation. God is going to restore them back again in chapter 36. And now 37, God has taken Ezekiel to show him a vision on a valley of dry bones. And God told Ezekiel to prophesy to this valley of dry bones. And as he prophesied, these dry bones got together and became a being. And then he prayed to the winds, and bread came upon these dry bones, and they eventually came into a mighty army of God. And what I'm going to share to you today is about this valley of dry bones, this vision. Because in the Old Testament, you see the men of God and the women of God are very often they heard from God, they had dreams, they had visions, they communicated with God on a very regular basis. And many of us nowadays lack that. And one of the reasons is because our focus is on television instead of having a vision from the Lord. Our focus is on other things. We do not spend enough time in the Word. We do not spend enough time meditating. We do not spend enough time praying. We do not spend enough time waiting. We do not spend enough time to be connected with God. We are in this fast world, this microwave world where everything must happen. And because of that, we've lost the connection. I encourage you today. That's so important. And you see, in this valley of dry bones, is a vision given to Ezekiel, because at that time the children of God, the Israelites, were in a very desperate, bad state. In fact, you look at the valley of dry bones, it describes the condition they were in, it describes the feeling that they were going through, it describes the utter hopelessness they were in. They were taken to captivity because of disobedience, because of sin, because of idolatry. They went into captivity under the Babylon Empire, Nebuchadnezzar, and they were captured. They lost their land, their temple was destroyed, and they were in utter hopelessness. That's the state they were as this vision was given to Ezekiel. And sometimes as we look at this vision, we can relate to ourselves at this moment because of this COVID-19 and because of the impact that it has, is having on the entire world. It's affected our livelihood, it's affected our business, it's affected our work, it's affected people's peace, it's affected people going to church, it's affected many things. And some of us are feeling this way. Some of us, because business has come so bad in our life, that we feel as if it's utter loss. We feel as if it's a valley of dry bones. Like everything is coming from bad to worse. We try to pick up and suddenly the COVID cases increases again and it gets worse. And some of us maybe have lost hope. And some of us maybe are so depressed and down. And today I'm going to encourage you through this message that God gave Ezekiel to speak into the lives of the children of God, that there is hope. Even though you might see with your carnal senses, you can see, you can feel, you can taste, in all the senses, it seems hopeless. Use all your logic, use all your intelligence, use all your reasoning. It might feel it's impossible, but through this text today, we realize that our God is a miracle working God. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to unpack this text here and identify certain important steps or lessons that we can help you so that you can see your breakthrough. That valley of dry bones, you're going to see it being transformed into a mighty army of God. Not just transformed into a normal human being, but transformed into a mighty army, a powerful machinery that's going to do great and wonderful things in your life. So encourage you. The first thing we see here is Ezekiel was taken to valley of dry bones. Normally, nobody likes valleys. We like mountains. We like to give testimonies of the accomplishment we done, the promotion we got, the discovery. Always we give testimony. Nobody goes and talks about testimonies or testify things when they are in the valley. They feel that's very bad. But people don't realize we learn the most when we are in the valleys, actually. The greater lessons we get when we are in the valleys, like how you refine gold. Gold is only refined through the heat. And the more the heat, you can remove the dross. You heat more, you remove the dross. Eventually, you get pure gold. And we are made better and better and ready to be used by God in a very powerful way in the furnace of affliction. So this is important. When you go to a valley, the first thing we got to learn is, what is God teaching us in the valley? Because the faster you learn, the faster you come out. The longer you learn, the longer you stay there. Because God wants to train you, God wants to build you, God wants to teach you, so God can send you to a higher place next time. Or God can use you in a different way. But a valley is where we learn. And here we look at this valley, we see a lot of things. And the first thing we see, the valley is full of bones. If you can picture it, it's a valley, a vast place, and it's all bones scattered. Multitudes of people, bones, just bones. And the bones are not connected, they're separated. The bones that are related to your arm might be separate, one side of the leg might be separate. And that is the condition, it's a multitude. And that is the state that is sometimes sin is like that. There's multitude of sin. When you don't deal with your sin, it keeps increasing and multiplying. When you harbor sin, when you harbor certain hidden sins or hidden habits, and the enemy will use that as a door to enter into your life and it'll bring more evil spirits. And because of that, you are filled with a multitude of many of them, and sometimes it can be a legion of evil spirit. And the same thing in our life, sometimes situation can come, it seems it's too much. You got too much of loans to pay, you got too much of problems coming. You one problem hit you and the next problem is coming and you don't know what to do. It's like this valley of dry bones. Not only they were a multitude of dry bones separated, but the Bible says also the bones were very dry, very dry. It was a hopeless state. It's a valley of dry bones. Bones that come from a human being is just bones. It's a multitude of human beings. The bones are there. And not only is a valley of dry bones, but the bones are dry. And they were unburied. And sometimes because of sin, and sin can cause that to our life. Because of disobedience, it can cause that in our life. It can cause things so that it can bring destruction in our life that we lay exposed to the world. That's why you see many times, because we keep on sinning, we don't repent. At one time you lay exposed, like these bones were exposed. We lay exposed and then we feel embarrassed and we feel shy at the world. Why? Because we refuse to repent. People have spoken into our life. Through the sermon they've spoken, but we keep on going thinking that no one will know. No one will find out. But eventually God will expose it from the mountaintop. We see that happening in many people's life, in Christians, in pastors, in churches, where they've abused their position, abused the money, and suddenly from the mountaintop is exposed. And this is what happens, and we must take care of it. And we see here the stories about the nation of Israel. It's focused on the nation of Israel. The condition they were in, they were state of hopelessness because they were captivity. They had no land of their own. They had no temple to go and worship. The temple is so important for them. And they were taken into captivity and they were in a hopeless state. And we relate to this, and we can also relate to it to our own life. When you give in to sin, sin gets the better. When you give in to habits, habits gets the better of us until we lose our identity, until we crave for the habits. Nothing else is important. Our relationship is affected. Our peace is affected. Our health is affected. And it goes on. Sometimes we You can look at this dryness, this valley of dry bones. You can talk about our business. We're talking about this COVID-19 has affected people's business. It seems like we are in this dry place now and things are not happening. Growth is not happening. Our opportunities are not coming. Sometimes our marriage looks like that, in a dry place. Things don't seem to work out. Sometimes our relationship with our children, sometimes the addiction habit, sometimes our own life, many things seem like a dry bone. So when you look at this, even though we know it's a story that's related to Israel, but we can also relate it to us today as children of God. We can also relate to the church. Sometimes in a church we see it's like a valley of dry bone. People just come to church for the sake of coming, for the sake of fulfilling their conscience, but there's no life in them. There's no excitement. There's no passion for Jesus Christ. There's no passion for the dying world out there. It's all like an exclusive club. And when you preach the word is not penetrating them. Sometimes as preachers, when we preach, I'm sure every preacher in the world will agree with me that sometimes in churches you go, you're preaching to a valley of dry bones. Nobody will show any reaction. Nobody will agree. They disagree. They are just looking into your face with blankness. And the only way you can excite yourself is I used to look at the wall and preach to the wall. I think that's better than looking in their faces sometimes. And that's how some places are. It's like a valley of dry bones. And the last thing we can relate to a valley of dry bones is lost souls. The multitude of dry bones. The multitude of souls out there that we are supposed to speak word, that we are supposed to have a passion for. Sometimes we get caught up with all the limelight, we get caught up with the materialism, with money, with fame, and we lose sight of souls. We lose sight of souls. We focus on people, we focus on position, we focus on richness, and we forget what is our purpose on this earth. Why has God called us? Go ye into the world and preach the word. That is what we're supposed to do. And then it can relate to us. That is the valley of the dry bone. And one more thing we can talk about, the valley of dry bone. When Ezekiel was taking a vision to his valley of dry bone, the Bible tells us, we read it here, he says, and the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me in the spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the midst of the valley, which is full of bone, and caused me to pass by them round about. And behold, there are many in the valley, and lo, they were very dry. He passed round about them, the Bible says. He passed round about them. That means, it very clearly gives you another important point that Ezekiel passed round the valley of dry bones. He didn't step on them. He didn't disrespect them. He passed round. And that's what we are supposed to do. When you do the ministry, when you reach out to people, you'll meet people of all kinds of colors. You'll meet people of all kinds of status. You'll meet people of all kinds of behavior. We are not supposed to step on them. They might be a drug addict. They might be an alcoholic. They might be somebody poor. It might be somebody with a skin color that's different from you. But we are not supposed to look down on them. We are not supposed to step on them. We are supposed to give them respect. That's why it's so important for us in church. When people shake hands, we shake hands, we look at their face and shake hands. We cannot be so busy like a politician. We are looking somewhere and shaking hands with somebody because he's not important, he's not rich, he's not contributing enough. So I don't give him the attention. You are supposed to respect and love everyone equally. That's what it shows you. We must bear that in mind. The second thing we can learn here is, the Bible says in verse 1, the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord. The second point we need to learn for us to go through the situation, for us to see God's blessing, what we need to be led by the Spirit. Second point is important, we must be led by the Lord. That's why he says, and the hand of the Lord was upon me and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me in the midst of the valley. We need to be led. What is the most important thing in our life is you must be led by the Lord. Are you led by the Lord? Are you doing things according to God's purpose or according to your own fancies, or somebody else has told you? No, you must check your life, what you're doing. If you're in a ministry, are you doing it because you love the Lord, because you're out there to reach out the soul? In your job, in your studies, is that what God wants you to do? Is that God's purpose? Is that business God wants you to do? Does God want you to start something and seek God's face and find out what is it? So when you're, whatever you're doing, you are sure that this is what God has called me to do. And if God has called me to do, God will prosper me. God will empower me. God will favor me. So here you see, Ezekiel could be taken to a valley of dry bones and not freeze in fear and not end up in depression because the hand of the Lord was upon him. And that must be our main desire, that God's hand is upon us. We do the work of God. We work in the secular world. We minister to people. What we need more than your academic qualification or your teaching from Bible school, you need God's hand. You need God's presence to be there. Because when God's presence is there, miracles happen. God will empower you. God will stir you up. God will keep you going. We need God's hand. So it's important for us to be in the will of God. What you allow to lead you or influence you will determine your future. Ask yourself today, what is it? I met certain people nowadays, they go to study in Bible school, they come out, and the only thing they're talking about is how much of money you get. They have lost, like, I went to full-time ministry more than 20 years ago. I went by faith. I haven't taken a single cent of salary from that time till now. I don't take money. People call me to do any ministry, I go and do. They bless me as the Lord leads. I don't dictate. I don't take salary from the church. That's what I've been living. People call me to do a wedding. People call me to do a funeral. I don't ask anything. I'll just go and do what God has called me, and I'll do my best. And nowadays, people ask, oh, you do a wedding, you get a lot of money. Oh, you do a funeral. It's all about money. They have lost that passion for Jesus. So what is leading you? If it's Jesus Christ, if the Holy Spirit, if it's to do the will of God, if it's a channel of blessing, God will prosper you. God will make a way. God will turn that valley of dry bones into a mighty army of God. So the important thing we need to ask ourselves, what is leading us? Is it the Holy Spirit? Is it God? Or is it your selfish desires? In Matthew chapter 13, verse 1 to 23, he talks about the parable of the sower. And you can see very clearly the parable of the sower when the seed was thrown in different grounds. The seed was thrown in the rocky ground. The seed was thrown in the thorny soil. Thorny soil cares more about the things of the world than the good news about God. And the seed cannot grow. And the seed was sown into good ground, a heart that's good ground, 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. So you must be careful where your heart is caught up with. If your heart is caught up with the worldly things, you cannot prosper in the eyes of God. The things of the world will come and choke you. The things of the world will get the better of you. So your focus must be on God. You must be led of God. So as children of God, whatever you're doing, whether in ministry, whether in full-time, whether in church, whether you're working or your own business, you must be led by the Holy Spirit. You must honor God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. You must be led. You must be grabbed by a fresh passion to live a life sold out for God. Are you sold out for God? Many people, we start off our life, we're sold out for God, we're passionate, and after a while, there's no more passion for God, there's passion for all kinds of other things. We just come to church, we do the work as if it's a vocation, and we have lost it. And now today, I want to ask you the question, are you led by the Holy Spirit? Are you sold out for God? Are you being led? Are you being grabbed by God's presence in your daily quiet time in church? Are you loving to spend time with God? Are you loving to pray? Are you loving to read the word? Is there something within you pushing you? Or it comes a drudgery or something that's so hard, a chore in your life? I want to be led. I want to be grabbed by God's heart for the lost, the broken, the hurt, the lonely, the hungry, the naked, the thirsty. Are you doing that? Are we doing that? Are we grabbed or are we led by the Holy Spirit to go out to those people who are suffering? Or are we just looking for some rich people or some expensive places so we can dine and be happy? Are we caught up with the heart of God? We need to ask ourselves that today. Or are we busy being a politician and trying to influence people without the power of the Holy Spirit? Are you led or grabbed by God's power, refiring that faith in the power of God? The power of prayer, the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of the life lived, yielded to God. Are you caught up? Are you allowing the Holy Spirit to grab you? Are you Holy Spirit to lead you? That your fire within you will burn once that passion will burn. That power will move upon you. Power for your prayer life. Power by the Holy Spirit. Power to live a life that's yielded to the Holy Spirit. Are you grabbed or led by the Holy Spirit to love the Word of God? Are you caught up with the word that you just love this word? You want to read and read and you cannot get enough of the word. You want to read and meditate and pray that the Holy Spirit will bring forth revelation and truth. Are you doing that? Or are we just caught up with some mind game where we just tickle our mind with some commentaries and other people's stuff, but we don't have that heart anymore, that passion. So we must be led today. how to be led by the Holy Spirit. First thing, we position ourselves so that we are in line with God. Position yourself by prayer and fasting. When you pray and fast, you align yourself under the will of God. Second thing we got to do is we got to give God priority. God should be number one. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. And he also says, if you seek me with all your heart, you'll find me. Put God first. Give God number one place in your life. Not the least, not only when you got problems, but give him a hunger for more of God. Hunger for more of God. Keep your heart right with God. Leave out any bitterness. Get right. Confess some hidden sins you have. Get right with God. Resist the distraction of life that try to grab you. There are a lot of things that try to draw you away from God. A lot of activities, a lot of things that come in, but you only put God. Be open to change. There's no shortcut here. In verse 4, he says, he asked him first, can these bones live? And Ezekiel answered, thou knowest. In verse 4, he said, again he said unto me, prophesy these bones, and say unto them, O ye dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus said the Lord of God unto these bones, behold, I will cause bread to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews upon you, and bring up flesh upon you, and cover you with skin, and put bread in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am Lord. Prophesy to these bones. The word prophesy here means, come from the original word, which means speak forth, to preach. And that is so powerful. When you start to speak forth the living word, when you start to speak forth the word that God gave you to speak, like how here God gave directly to Ezekiel to speak forth this word, speak to the valley of the dry bones. When you speak to a dry bones, suddenly the dry bones get ears because they hear. When you speak, you command the mountain, be gone, and it'll be gone, it'll go. Why suddenly it'll have ears? When you start to speak the word that God gives you. So when you speak the right word, the prophetic word, when you speak the promises of God, it's rightfully ours, you see a miracle happen. That is the power of the word of God. So I encourage you, you must speak the living word of God into your situation. You cannot speak negativity. You cannot speak hopelessness. You cannot speak failure. You cannot speak lack. You cannot speak sickness in the carrier. You speak life. You speak healing. You speak restoration. You speak blessing. You speak prosperity. You speak soul. You speak the promises of God. There are many promises of God for us as Christians. And what we need, we take the promise and speak it. Speak it, because there's power in the word of God. Paul said this in 1 Corinthians 2:4. My preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but a demonstration of spirit and power. In Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and the joints and marrow, and a discerner of the thoughts and the intent of the hearts. That's the power of the word of God. Learn to meditate. You're going through difficulties. Get the promises of God. Get all the promises. You're going to sickness. Get all the promises of healing. You're going to depression. Get all the promises of peace. You're going to difficulty. Get all the promises and start to speak it. Speak it, speak it, speak it, speak it, speak it, speak it. Keep on speaking until you see the miracles. Isaiah 55:11 says, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing which I sent. The word of God is, you must speak the word. When you speak the word of God, the living, it won't come back to God empty. It won't come back to God unfulfilled. It won't come back to God void. It'll fulfill, because it is a promise of God. 1 Corinthians 1:20, all the promises of God in him are yea and amen unto the glory of God. All the promises of God are yes in him. So that's why you and I need to hold on to the word of God. Other things can fail you, but the word of God won't fail you. You hold on to the word of God, you will see it coming through. Luke 4:4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. Ezekiel looked at the situation. He assessed the situation correctly, but then he believed in the word of God. I'm not telling you deny what you're facing. What you see is what you see. That's true. Don't deny. Don't pretend. Don't live in self-denial. But then you depend on God for a miracle, that God is going to change it. Some of us have bought into a wrong teaching where we seem to deny. When you got sickness, we say we got no sickness. When you got problems, you got depression, we say you got no depression, and nobody can help you. Yes, you got it, but you know that you can get help. You can get people to pray for you, that our God is a God of miracles. You need to accept it and believe that there is a way out through Jesus Christ. Not living in self-denial. Sometimes very sad when I approach people, ask them, do you need prayers? No, no, I'm okay, I'm fine. Actually, they're suffering from cancer. And one day you see they've died. And I ask them why they were having cancer, but never told anybody else, because they felt by telling people means they have no faith. No. you tell people and you have faith that they will pray for you, and you have faith that God can do the miracle. Don't live in self-denial. Speak the truth. Get help. Believe that God can do a miracle. The Bible says in Proverbs 21, death and life are in the power of the tongue. There's power in your words. So guard your words. Speak the living word. Speak the promise. Speak the word into people's life. Speak the word into your life. Many times David spoke the word. He comforted himself. He comforted his soul by the word. Speak the word to yourself. Speak the word to people. Speak the promises. Speak the promise. Because there's power in their life. Speak the word to your children. Speak the word to your family. Speak the word. Pray the word. Meditate on the word. Maybe you have even looked at many things in your life like they were dry bones. Maybe it's your marriage, maybe it's your finances, maybe it's your business, maybe it's your dreams, maybe it's your family relationship, maybe it's your health, maybe it's the attitude. Whatever it is, I want to encourage you to speak the word. Speak the word. Mark 11:23 says, verily I say unto thee, whosoever shall say to this mountain, be thou be removed and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt his heart, but shall believe that those things which he said shall come to pass, and he shall have whatsoever he said. Speak. That's why he meant prophesy. Jesus told. This is one of the weapons we see in this great miracle. One of the steps we see in a great miracle was prophesy or speak forth. Speak forth. Like we preach the word from the pulpit. We preach the word at times of difficulty we are facing. COVID-19, people are down. We as preachers, you're not supposed to put jokes and jokes and jokes. Let the jokers do that. Let those people who are experts in that. You speak the word. Speak the word. Speak the word. People need the word. The word will encourage. The word will build. The word will stir. The word will cause miracles. Speak the word. You see a lot of people on Facebook, instead of preaching the word, pastors, they are continuously putting jokes and entertaining people. They've lost trust in the word of God or what? Get the word. People need the word. In desperate times, they need the word more than anything else. They need the living word to be encouraged. Get the word. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. When he spoke forth, prophesied the word, bones came, bones. Sinews came and everything. See, the Bible said, so I prophesied, verse 7. As I prophesied, there was a noise. There was a behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to bone. And I beheld, and lo, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered above, and there was no breath in them. This is what happened. He prophesied, bones came. Joined, the flesh came, the sinews came, everything came together as a human being that came, but yet there was no breath. There's a lot of noise. Sometimes when you don't have the Holy Spirit, there'll be a lot of noise people make to replace the Holy Spirit. They'll have smoke machine in case of Holy Spirit, they have smoke going around. Not against smoke machines, but you cannot replace the Holy Spirit with a smoke machine. We got a lot of noise there. We control the lights to make you feel as if God is there, but nothing can replace the presence of the Holy Spirit. You want to do everything else, go ahead, but make sure the desire for the presence of God to be the highest in whatever you do, because that is what is going to transform lives. Because he came there, bone upon bone. They joined together. A lot of noise. Sometimes we got a lot of noise, but no power. In our life, we see many times a lot of noise. You go to some churches, a lot of noise, some music, a lot of noise, but there's no power. We want power. We don't want to mesmerize people with your abilities and skills. And after coming there, after a while, they just go back and everything disappears. We want them to come and be touched by the Holy Spirit. Whether there's a lot of noise or little noise, whatever it is, the power of God must be there. So that people's life will change. So we need the power of the Holy Spirit. Because here, what the instruction was, Ezekiel was, then he said unto verse 9, prophesy unto the wind, prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus said the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon the slain, that they may live. So I prophesy, and as he commanded me, the breath came upon them, and they lived. And they stood up upon their feet, an exceeding great army. They lived! So I encourage you today, when the Holy Spirit comes, you might feel like giving up your life. You might feel like suicidal thoughts will come. You might feel like no hope. They lived when the Holy Spirit came. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to come in our life. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to come through our depression and bring life. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to come and cause healing. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to come and cause restoration. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to come and restore our business, restore our job, restore us. And they lived. And God is speaking to you today. Even though you feel like there's no more hope, even though you feel like giving up on your life, and the Bible talks very clearly. When the prophesies the wind, the power of the wind represents the Holy Spirit came, and they lived. God will bring life. Jesus came to give us life and life more abundant. No matter what you're facing, don't give up. Get up and face another day. Because why? God can turn things around. Never throw in the towel. Never give up. Keep on fighting, because God can turn things around. Just one word from the Lord. Just one touch from the Lord. Just one encounter from the Lord. Things can change overnight. God can turn a person who was bankrupt into a multimillionaire. God is able. God is able to touch you and heal you from terrible disease. God is able to break addiction. God is able to restore. God is able. And the power, we need the power of the Holy Spirit. The conclusion was, they turned into a mighty army of God. The Bible says, so I prophesied and he commanded me, and the bread came to them and they lived and stood up on their feet exceeding great army. That is the power of God. From a valley of dry bones, very dry bones, scattered dry bones, multitudes of dry bones, end of it, God showed the vision that God can turn it into a mighty army, not just a normal human being, but a mighty army that will go forth and have victory after victory. And after that, what God can do to you, God can do to your life, God can do to your family, God can do to your business, that's going to take you to different levels, different heights. They're going to do greater things. All you have to do is just simply obey these words of God. Prophesy the word. Be obedient. Have faith in God and tap onto the Holy Spirit. Have an encounter with God. We need an encounter. All of us need an encounter. Hallelujah. God bless you. Be praying for you. Continue to fight. Continue to press on. Live one more day to see that miracle. Never throw in the towel. Never give up. Because our God is a miracle working God. God bless you. Amen. Shalom.